So, good afternoon, everybody, and thank you all for coming to this talk and this discussion on this very important issue. So, as Ed mentioned, I was very fortunate and grew up in South Africa's Kruger National Park, which is home to more of the world's rhino than any other protected area on the planet. And for this reason, the Kruger National Park in South Africa is also the center of the current poaching crisis. So while I was growing up in Kruger, while I was growing up in Kruger, the typical thing you do when you live in Kruger is when you're in school, your parents take you on a Sunday game drive. That's your Sunday activity, and you go and check out the animals and enjoy the bush. And on such a game drive, I would typically have run into a scene like this. A white rhino resting in the middle of the road. And if you visit Kruger National Park today, as I'm sure some of you have done recently, you can still enjoy the experience of observing these marvelous animals at very close range. So zooming forward a little bit in my life, shortly after I handed in my PhD, which was at James Cook University in 2011, I was asked by South African National Parks to be based in Kruger National Park once again and to develop a tourism research program to build tourism thinking and tourism research into conservation decision making. It was during this time, when I was once again based in Kruger, that I became aware of the acute and serious nature of this rhino poaching crisis. And some of my friends and colleagues that I'd grown up with there in Kruger were out many nights of the week fighting rhino poachers, trying to catch poachers, trying to prevent them from killing rhinos. There were helicopters from the police, from the army, from the national park buzzing overhead all the time. I remember clearly one afternoon earlier last year, returning home from, yes, a Sunday game drive, and there was a roadblock in front of me, just on the way to my house, a few kilometers from where I lived. And I looked around and saw, well, what's happening here? And the bush was crawling with police officers, with people from the army, with people from national parks armed with assault rifles. They were looking for poachers that were in custody, that had escaped from custody, that were recently caught poaching rhino. So this poaching crisis and the fight against it is turning the Kruger National Park into a low-level war zone. And with my background in economics and social science, and from talking to a range of experts while I was in South Africa, working for national parks and thereafter, it became clear to me that the poaching crisis could sensibly be addressed by instituting a carefully structured legal trade in rhino horn. Having grown up in the Kruger National Park, it's a place very close to my heart. I do not like seeing these animals being killed. I do not like seeing where I grew up turning into a war zone unnecessarily. I was therefore inspired to review the literature on this issue and to write up a paper that presents the scientific evidence for a legal trade in Africa's rhino horn. To do this, I teamed up with Rowan Martin, who is from Zimbabwe, who's worked closely on this issue for over 50 years, Frank Auchamp, who's in France, and Hugh Possingham here at the University of Queensland. We submitted a paper to Science, and that was published a few weeks ago. The paper attracted extensive media attention, both in Australia and internationally, and a lot of the journalists who reported on the paper spoke out in favor of the arguments for a legal trade, saying that it was a pragmatic solution. There was also strong opposition from other groups, including conservation NGOs. So just before I get into the details of my talk and about a legal trade, just to get a sense of the audience here, how many of you have read this paper or other issues relating to the debate over a legal trade in rhino horn? Just raise your hand. About a third of you, okay? And again, to get a sense of the audience, how many of you are biologists or ecologists? Raise your hand. Most of you. And economists, social scientists, or political scientists? One. None. Okay. I'm talking to biologists. Great. So, getting into my talk then. The outline of my talk today, I'll be talking about the current poaching crisis. I'll talk about the history of rhino populations in Africa, which is an important part of this issue. I'll be discussing the conditions for a successful legal trade. I'll be talking about some of our thoughts around the structure of a legal trade, how we could manage uncertainties in illegal trade and the safeguards that we could put in place. And then I'll wrap up my talk with a discussion of the response to my paper and the road to a possible future legal trade. So, this is the poaching crisis we're sitting with at the moment. Since 2007, the number of rhino poached annually in South Africa has on average more than doubled. That's from, I'm not sure if you can see the numbers at the back there, from 13 rhino in 2007 to 668 last year. And in January, February, and March this year, there have already been 200 rhino poached. So we're looking to exceed that 668 number this year again. The reason for the escalation in poaching is because of the price of rhino horn. This has increased from around $4,700 per kilogram in 1993 to the estimates that are going around now of $65,000 per kilogram in, that's last year. Some investigative journalists operating in Asia have reported numbers double that, $65,000. But working with the $65,000, your average white rhino, its horn is 4 kilograms. If you poach that rhino, you get hold of the horn, that's over $250,000. Once that product reaches the East. So, talking about an animal that's got tremendous value in terms of its horn. This escalating price is due to persistent and growing demand for horn in the face of restricted supply. And the supply is restricted because of the CITES, the Convention on the Trade of Endangered Species, the trade ban that's been in place on the trade in rhino products that's been there since 1977. And some of you may have seen in the news, and again, another indication of the tremendous value of rhino horn and the lengths to which criminals will go to source it. There have been spectacular robberies of horns from rhinos in museums in Europe, where they break into the museum, break through the security, and cut off the horn of the rhino that's in the museum. So what is rhino horn used for? Traditionally, it's been used for dagger handles in Yemen. And importantly, it's also been used in traditional Chinese medicine for 2,000 years. It's from a lot of what I've read, it's a high status and expensive medicine. So if you're a rich man and you have some ailment, that's the medicine that you can afford to go and buy. And according to a recent CITES and traffic report, the recent escalation in price is mainly fueled by demand in East Asia, and it's related to the rapid economic growth in that part of the world. More people can afford rhino horn, more people are wanting to buy it, and that's pushing up the price. Vietnam was singled out as the main import country at the recent CITES meeting in March in Bangkok. And in Vietnam, yes, rhino horn is used for a range of expensive cures. It's also being now used and promoted for a range of other things that I think one could argue extend beyond traditional Chinese medicine, such as a hangover cure after you've been to a party, or as a party drug if you mix it with certain forms of alcohol. But because of its entrenched history of use, attempts to educate users or to raise awareness in China and in Asia for people to not use rhino horn have failed. Also, dehorning rhino, when a rhino is darted and the horn is removed so that you reduce the incentive to poachers, that's been proven to not be that effective if you don't provide additional security to that rhino that's been dehorned because of the value of the remaining horn stumps. The poachers still go in there and they remove the horn, and that's still there. It's still worth their while doing that. Now, a very, very important point in this, and it's a point that I really need to emphasize when I'm talking outside of South Africa, and that is that rhinos do not need to be killed to harvest their horn. Rhino horn is composed of keratin, so it regrows when cut. So for example, this rhino with a calf, you can see the horn is busy regrowing. That horn, if there was a legal market, could have been used to supply the market with horn. This rhino is wandering out around the bush having a good time. In 2 or 3 years, you can harvest that horn again, another $250,000 towards money that could contribute towards conservation. However, because of the current trade ban, the demand for horn relies on the illegal killing of rhinos to supply that demand. And the legal, humane harvest from live animals to supply the market obviously is not possible under a trade ban. So we end up with situations like this. So a little bit more about the current poaching crisis. In this image here is one of the helicopters that belongs to South African National Parks. It's based in Kruger National Park. And while I was working there and I continue to engage with national parks on a regular basis, it's very clear that this war on poaching, as they call it, is taking resources away from other conservation actions. A friend and colleague of mine that I grew up with in the Kruger National Park and spent time with there earlier in my life is one of the helicopter pilots for this machine, and he tells me that more and more they're having to cancel research activities, other monitoring activities that they need the helicopter for, because they need the helicopter to look for rhino poachers. My father has worked for Scientific Services for South Africa National Parks and Kruger for over 20 years, and he complains to me that there is more and more pressure on their research budgets, on their monitoring budgets, because so many resources have to go into the fight against rhino poaching. Importantly, this war on poaching is also increasingly costly in human lives. And it's not only game reserve staff, it's the police and the army officers that are involved, and it's the poachers that often come from low-income communities around national parks or areas where there are rhino. So, moving on to a history of rhino numbers in Africa, which is an important part of the story. And for the purpose of this talk, I'll focus at the species level. I won't go into the subspecies. At the species level, there are two different types of rhino. The black rhino, which is smaller and typically more aggressive and erratic and unpredictable, and the white rhino, which is quite a lot bigger and a more peaceful animal. And that name white rhino actually comes from wide rhino, and for those of you who've seen the animal will know why it's called the wide rhino. It's a pretty big animal. Now, here's a map of Africa that's not come out that well. Just for anyone who's not familiar with the geography, the two countries of importance here, South Africa is down at the southern tip of Africa, and Namibia, which is, as Ed mentioned, is where I was born. So in 1970, there were 65,000 rhino outside of South Africa and Namibia. By 1994, remember the trade ban was installed or put in place in 1977. By 1994, there were only 2,410 left alive in total in South Africa, Namibia, and the rest of the continent. Today, there are slightly over 5,000, primarily due to population growth in South Africa and Namibia, which now hold over 80% together of the world's population of black rhino. White rhino, extinct in the wild outside of South Africa in 1910. In 1910, there were only 100 left in South Africa, and a conservation agency called Natal Parks Board, now called KZN Wildlife, played a really critical role in restoring the species. And the restoration of the population of white rhino has been very successful, and today there are over 20,000 white rhino, of which over 90% are in South Africa. So why has South Africa and Namibia, why have they been successful in turning around the populations of the black and the white rhino? They've had good management and law enforcement around their protected areas and their private nature reserves. These rhinos hold tourism value, so it's money from tourism in places like the Kruger National Park have played an important role in enabling agencies like South African National Parks to fund law enforcement and fund management. Rhinos also hold value to private landholders, and this is important. Again, because of tourism, they may have domestic or international tourists coming to visit to see the rhino. Rhino sales. Now, in South Africa, the legislation works as such: if you've got wildlife on your property, that is your wildlife. It belongs to you. You can sell it. So people would buy white rhino, the price of rhino would go up because more people want rhino. You might have a calf, you can sell that rhino, you can sell the calf over time. So you've got financial value of having the rhino on your property. And importantly for white rhino as well in South Africa, high-end commercial hunting. Commercial hunters come out and they pay tens of thousands of dollars to be able to hunt these rhino. And while some people may disagree with that practice, I personally do not hunt myself. I don't find the value in that. But that industry has meant that there's been a lot of money flowing to the conservation of white rhino and their habitat. So this success in South Africa and Namibia of conserving these animals has been linked to a strong conservation ethic which exists in those countries and those societies, together with a financial incentive for the ownership and the management of rhinos. However, under the current poaching crisis, this success is under threat. As from the numbers I showed you earlier, the populations are under threat from escalating poaching. So the increase that we've seen in black and white rhino in recent decades is now seriously under threat because poaching is escalating so rapidly. It's becoming too risky and dangerous for small reserves and private landholders to have rhino. The rhino do not have the value to them that meets the risks that having those rhinos are there. The poachers are well armed, they're willing to use all sorts of things, helicopters, assault rifles, to get at those rhinos, so you actually do not want those rhino on your property if you're a small landholder. And there's been, since the poaching crisis emerged in 2008, there's been increased restrictions on the sale of horn domestically within South Africa and export of trophies from professional hunts or commercial hunts. And this has decreased incentives for ownership. I mentioned earlier the value of rhino sales to landholders for keeping white rhino. The price of white rhino has decreased substantially since the poaching crisis started, and therefore there's less financial incentive for these landholders to have these rhino. Right, so what's the potential role and what are the prospects of illegal trade in Africa's rhino horn to address this crisis? Firstly, the harvesting of the horn. Sedating a rhino to harvest its horn can be done for as little as $20. Now, this isn't a very good quality picture, but they're busy dehorning that rhino there. And as per that picture I showed you earlier, after you've harvested the horn, taken off the horn, that rhino runs around the bush again, the savannah. With current technology, there's very little risk to the animal. There is limited evidence of significant behavioral change when the rhino doesn't have the horn. And as I mentioned, the horn regrows after a few years, like a fingernail does. And the horn production from a white rhino averages 0.9 kilograms per year. So the current estimated amount, and this is a speculative estimate because it's based on the seizures of illegal horns, and we don't really know the market that well because it's a black market, but the current estimated amount for horn could be met by the 5,000 white rhino on private land in South Africa alone. The supply could be augmented by the sale of horns from stockpiles and natural mortality. So, what are the conditions for the success of illegal trade in reduced poaching? And in our paper, we reviewed the evidence of what types of trade regimes in which types of wildlife products have led to reduced pressure on wild populations. And I'll summarize those here. Firstly, the conditions. Regulators can prevent the laundering of a threatening level of illegal trade under the cover of illegal trade. That buying horn legally is easier, more reliable, and more cost-effective than sourcing your horn from the illegal trade. That demand does not escalate to dangerous levels after the stigma of illegality is removed. And that legally harvested horns can substitute for horns from illegally killed animals. Right, so I'm going to go over these conditions one by one in the case of illegal trade in rhino horn. Firstly, that regulators can prevent the laundering of a threatening level of illegal trade under the cover of illegal trade. The technology now exists to track the legality of individual horns through the selling chain to the end consumer, and this will minimize laundering and illegal sales. Each legal rhino horn can carry a small traceable transponder, which is identifiable through the market chain to the buyer. Second condition, the legal supply can deliver the product more easily, reliably, and cost-effectively than the illegal trade, which relies on poaching and killing the animals. Cost information from landholders with rhino accounting for land management and horn harvesting costs shows that the cost-effectiveness, the reduced risk, and the lower transaction costs associated with the illegal market are likely to attract buyers away from the black market. Third condition, the demand does not escalate to dangerous levels as the stigma of illegality is removed. If under illegal trade there is increased demand for horn, this could be met by sales from the large stockpiles of horns that exist in South Africa to dampen the price, and from increasing the amount of land that holds rhino. White rhino populations grow at 8% per annum if provided with appropriate savanna habitat. So those of you who've had the fortune of visiting the Kruger National Park in recent years, if you travel around what's called the southern shoe of Kruger, moister savanna habitat down there. White rhino is probably the most abundant animal that you run into, most abundant large mammal. And their population grows really quickly if provided with appropriate habitat. White rhino are an umbrella species, and if under illegal trade in rhino horn, we need to expand the land that holds rhino so that we can harvest more horn. This will hold broader benefits for conservation and for communities. Fourth condition for success, legally harvested horns can substitute for horns from illegally killed animals. The horn from a live rhino is exactly the same product as from a killed rhino, so experts close to the issue indicate that there should be no problem with substitutability. Right, so getting on to what a selling structure and a market structure could look like and how one could manage some of the uncertainties and risks associated with this. So in our paper, we've proposed that a central selling organization is one option for managing illegal trade. It's only one option, and there are debates around how you could structure illegal trade, but we, in the paper, presented the central selling organization, or the CSO option, because it has been evaluated in detail by CITES for a possible legal trade in ivory and has been reviewed by our co-author Rowan Martin in a separate report on a potential for a legal trade in rhino horn. A central selling organization would be supported by and accountable to CITES and the white rhino range states. It could be funded by a percentage of each horn sold, and the CSO would ensure that horn harvesting is humane and renewable, and that landholders that harvest and sell horns are contributing to broader conservation and community benefits in the areas in which their rhino occur. Importantly, a CSO would negotiate and manage the selling of horns so that it is more attractive, reliable, and cost-effective for buyers to obtain the product legally than through illegal means. So some more discussion on some of the uncertainty and safeguards. The CSO should be the only authority that can sell horns and only to registered buyers. The buyer's stockpiles should be subject to regular audits, and the buyers should process all the horns themselves. One option is that sales could take place through auctions at carefully guarded and closely monitored locations. Such a short and closely monitored market chain was also the type of market that was proposed for an ivory CSO. A short market chain can be more effectively controlled, and it limits the incentives for speculative hoarding and reduces the risk of corruption, because such a short market chain can have tight controls which are difficult to circumvent. Furthermore, at the outset of a legal trade, the sale of the 15 to 20 tons of stockpiled horns in South Africa could be used to attract buyers to the legal trade initially, and later sales from stockpiles can be used to dampen the price of horns should it escalate dangerously. The CSO should work in partnership with demand countries, CITES, and producers to ensure the strict enforcement of the legal trade. And under illegal trade, there will be more resources available for this enforcement and to fight illegal killings and poaching, because you'll be generating revenue from horn which you can use to enforce that. And very importantly, a monitoring and evaluation system should be established, and this should be funded by the sale of horns. This needs to be established so that an understanding of the market can be emerged. One of the big problems with having a trade ban and having a black market is that there is a limited understanding of the market. So you don't know who's demanding the product, what those characteristics are. This understanding of the market can support adaptive management of the trade, and the trade should be adaptively managed and can be restructured over time. So, moving on to crocodiles, and I'm talking about crocodiles because crocodiles represent a legal trade success story for conservation. And this part of my talk, I draw extensively from this paper by John Hutton and Graham Webb, where they review the success of a legal trade in crocodilians in taking pressure off wild populations. So as Hutton and Webb say, by the 1970s, there was concern over extinction of many crocodile species because they were under pressure from harvesting in the wild. In 1975, when CITES was introduced, many crocodilians were listed and the trade was restricted or banned. But from the late 1970s, there was a movement towards sustainable utilization in legal trade. And so trade before the 1980s was dominated by skins harvested from wild animals. After the 1980s, the vast majority of skins on the market originated from ranching and captive breeding. And as Hutton and Webb point out, the dramatic growth of ranching and captive breeding since the 1980s led to the emergence of a constituency amongst governments, NGOs, and the private sector who had a strong interest in combating the illegal trade. And again, according to Hutton and Webb, this was pivotal to the headway that CITES began to make against the large-scale illegal trade in crocodile products. So the crocodile example shows us that conservation incentives can and have been generated by markets, that the economic importance of the resource has led directly to stronger institutional arrangements for conservation and sustainable management, and that the illegal international trade, which flourished before CITES encouraged legal trade of crocodile products, has largely been eradicated. So one of the questions that's been put to me as I've been interviewed by a number of newspapers from around the world is, well, if there is this legal trade in rhino horn, a country like South Africa, Vietnam, they don't have the governance capacity to actually enforce this. And again, I point out to them that if one looks at the crocodile example, this is played out in a diversity of countries, some of them with very poor governance scores, including Zimbabwe, Venezuela, and Papua New Guinea. So if you have a carefully structured market that's tightly controlled, the fact that it operates in a country with a low governance score, you can get around that challenge. So moving on to the last part of my talk, the response to the paper and the possibility of a future legal trade. So actually the same day that our paper came out, independently the South African government, this is just the week before the CITES meeting started in Bangkok, openly stated that they're thinking about the legal trade as in rhino horn as the direction to deal with this poaching crisis. At the CITES meeting, I was not there myself, but I have a number of colleagues that were there. They had a number of side events where, again, they were making it clear to the other CITES parties and to the world that they're thinking seriously about this. This is Minister Edna Molewa, the Minister of Water and Environmental Affairs in South Africa, and soon after she got back from Bangkok to South Africa, in an interview, she stated for the first time that she thinks the legal trade is the right direction. So the South African government are seriously thinking about this and they want to push this. And the response to that, and often in newspaper pieces that talk about our paper, they include both stories, the South African government's position and our paper and what we're saying. And I've been positively surprised, and I think most of the newspaper coverage has been positive. And a journalist would typically write up, well, this is what the scientists have said about this issue, this is what the South African government is saying, this is what some of the NGOs that are opposed to the idea are saying, but this is the response from Dorn and his colleagues on this. And they acknowledge that while it's not a pleasant option, it's probably the most sensible option in the face of the current crisis. However, there is also a stiff opposition to our paper and the South African government's position. So there have also been interviews I've had with newspapers in Germany and elsewhere where clearly they've just taken extracts of what I've said and presented a story that's very anti-illegal trade. And the opponents of illegal trade, and both opponents to the idea put forward in our paper and the South African government's position, I would say typically fall into two camps, broadly speaking. The first camp is fierce opposition to the idea from protectionist NGOs. And the second is more qualified reservations about the uncertainty surrounding illegal trade, how it will work, and what is needed to actually put it in place. So I'm just going to talk about these a little bit. The fierce opposition, it's often ideological, and it's linked to entrenched ways of trying to deal with the threat of rhino poaching. And I say it's ideological because, although it's not stated, I get the sense, and I get this from informal conversations as well, that a lot of the people with this position really feel that using rhino horn is wrong, and that rhinos are there, they should be out in the wild running around, and that we shouldn't be thinking about how to supply the market with horns, we should be thinking about how to stop the poachers and how to stop people using horn, because rhinos, their horns shouldn't be used, and that's just wrong, and they should be left alone in the wild so we can go and see them. There's also the perspective that the horn should not be used and it has no scientifically demonstrated value. That's from a Western medical perspective. Yes, we attempt to find the substance, the chemical substance in rhino horns that people want, that they haven't found anything. And so people are saying, well, why should we want a product legalized which clearly has no value from a Western medical perspective? I also think an important part of this is that organizations have been fighting poaching for a long time. This has been a long-going battle. And if you're from an organization or you are an organization that's been fighting poaching since the 1970s with a belief that using rhino horn is wrong, and therefore the consumers are in the wrong, the people selling horn are in the wrong, and the poachers are in the wrong, it's very challenging to now think, okay, well, that strategy hasn't worked. Let's think about how we can provide horn to these people, because clearly they want it anyway. And because that means that you have to question a very deep assumption about how you think about this problem. And I think that's come out in some of the fierce opposition to our paper. As some of my colleagues in that are much closer to CITES and this issue than I am have pointed out, a lot of these groups have a lot of resources and media power. So some of the responses to our paper have put forward a critique that, you know, the authors of myself and my co-authors are naive and don't understand criminal networks and it's too dangerous to do this, but they do not provide any evidence, but they've got the media connections to push that story. So that's what the reader reads. The more qualified responses, they typically talk about, well, there's quite a lot of political agreement that's necessary for this legal trade to work. South Africa needs to get into agreement with Vietnam, China, the importing countries. That could be difficult. There needs to be international support. CITES need to support it. There's also a question around the structure of what a legal market should be. A central selling organization might not be the best. There are other options. There's also an important question about the nature of demand following legalization. The evidence from other products that have been legalized does suggest that there may be an increase in demand following legalization, and there is uncertainty around that. The more qualified critique has also questioned, well, yes, you point out how a CSO could enforce a legal trade and how it could work with CITES, but how will that actually work, and how can we make sure that those safeguards are strong? And actually, we just yesterday received a response letter from Science to our paper, and that was from a group of economists, and they actually agreed with the notion of a legal trade, but they brought forth these arguments as well. They said, look, well, it's not that simple. Yes, it's the right direction, but we need to think carefully about how it can work. So these are clearly very important issues that need research and evaluation in the consideration and planning towards a possible legal trade. So I think the way forward, there needs to be open and informed debate about these issues. I think people who feel that it's too risky, that demand may escalate out of control, they need to present evidence of that supporting that perspective, present their models, present their surveys in an evidence-based way so that we can see, okay, well, clearly these are some of the risks we need to think about. Importantly, I think there needs to be an acknowledgement of underlying values and ideologies. As I explained earlier, there are some of the groups who are stiffly opposed to the idea who clearly ideologically do not think that people should be using rhino horn and that rhino should be running around in the wild. And so, and that means that they aren't willing to think about an alternative solution to this problem. And I think exploring those underlying values and ideologies are important. I also think that it's important that we need to acknowledge historical cultural practices and uses and non-Western ways of evaluating traditional medicines. The line that's often been stated that, well, our scientists in Europe and the United States show that this using this horn leads to no benefit, that doesn't really mean much to your users in Vietnam and China, and actually, as a number of authors have pointed out, that smacks of imperialism, if you try and tell me that I can't use my product that I've been using for 2,000 years. So I think there needs to be more science, it needs to be an evidence-based discussion and an open debate, And we need to acknowledge these cultural differences and different perspectives. And in the response to my paper, that although there's been, or our paper, there's been a lot of opposition, there I have not yet seen strong, solid arguments with evidence against illegal trade. One of my colleagues who was at the CITES meeting said there was discussion in the corridors there from a group of authors, and people said, this is nonsense, this is just wrong, we're going to write a response to science because this paper of that suggests illegal trade in rhino horn is just ignoring too much. And I asked my colleague, well, what were the actual arguments? What were they saying? What are they concerned about? And the arguments, they didn't really have a solid argument, and I was looking forward to receiving this so I could think about, well, what are some of the real evidence-based critiques to the idea of illegal trade in rhino horn, and nothing's emerged. And I've seen that over and over again. And I think if someone has solid scientific evidence based on models or surveys or a trade in another product, they really need to bring that forward because that needs to become part of the debate. But we need to move beyond just the rhetoric of this is too dangerous and we cannot do it. So finally, in conclusion, the evidence strongly suggests that a carefully structured and adaptively managed legal trade will be more successful than the trade ban concerning Africa's rhino. And we need an open, informed, evidence-based debate that acknowledges different cultural perspectives and belief systems around this product. So, just to wrap up, I hope that with serious consideration of illegal trade and good, healthy, open discussion around that, that for many, many years to come, people can still visit where I grew up, the Kruger National Park in South Africa, and enjoy scenes such as this, which are really wonderful. White rhino grazing, running around a beautiful piece of African savannah. Thank you.